Welcomes us, welcomes Jesus Christ.
And whoever welcomes Christ welcomes the one who sent him.
If we welcome a prophet in the name of a prophet,
we will receive a prophet's spirit.
If we welcome a righteous person in the name of righteousness,
we will receive all righteousness's spirit.
Whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one so helpless,
truly we say,
Friends, the good news of the gospel is that through Christ's life, death, and resurrection, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. We now come to the part of the service where we ask the children to come down for the children's sermon at this time, please. I've got some ringers coming. I could tell you guys were nervous what was going to happen. Oh, hey, come on down. Well, thanks for coming. I appreciate it. All right, listen, we're going to talk today a little bit about being in charge. Do you feel like you're in charge?
No.
No? Okay. All right, well, let's split this up and let's talk about that. At school, who is in charge?
Me, the teacher.
The teacher? You are in charge of school? Okay. All right. You think the teachers in the print or the teachers are in charge at school? Okay. All right. What about at home? Who's in charge at home?
Parents.
My mom.
Parents. Your mother.
Not my dad.
Okay.
Just my mom.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, let's flesh this out. Okay. So at school, you think the teachers are in charge, but really, the principal is sort of in charge of the teachers. And then, right, if we go up even further, you know, the Board of Education is really kind of over the principal. And if we go up even further, then, you know, everybody who casts votes when we elect Board of Education, that's, you know, who's sort of in charge, right? Right? And so, you know, is anybody actually really in charge? Or they all, well, I mean, and there's a song from Bob Dylan, right? That says, you've got to serve somebody, right? Right? You have to serve somebody. And even like at home, right? You think, well, okay, my parents are in charge, but, you know, they've got a boss at work, right? There are policemen. They can't just do whatever they want, right? There are laws, okay? And so nobody is really in charge. Everybody has got somebody that they have to serve. And Paul tells us that it really boils down to two things, right? You've got to serve somebody. You're either serving God or you are serving sin, right? So you're either serving God or you're serving something else. And if you're serving something else, then that's sin because you're not putting God first, okay? So, right, we maybe aren't in charge, but guess what? Person who is in charge loves us very much, and that is something I think that we can be thankful for. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's pray together. I'll say some words, and then you say
my
some
mom
words
after. Very much.
She sure does, I know, and I bet she's in charge of a lot of things too. Okay, all right, let's pray. Dear God, we thank you
that
you are in charge.
Help us to
act
like it.
And we pray this
in
Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Now y'all can go and sit with your parents or back up at the balcony, whatever you want to do.
Let us pray. May the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, illuminate our thoughts and deeds, dear God. May the Holy Spirit fill us with the light of your love. In your name we pray. Amen. A reading from the letter to the Church of Rome, written by Paul. Beginning at chapter 7, verse 15. Listen, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate to do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. If I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind, making me a prisoner of the law of sin work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I've been working with a few books recently on a topic that's near to my heart, The Spirituality of Imperfection by Ernest Kurtz is one, Ernest Kurtz and Catherine Ketchum. Another is The Gifts of Imperfection by Brené Brown. I can't imagine what draws me to these titles about imperfection. Actually, I'm captivated and inspired by the insights of these authors. I wish that they had been available to Paul. He might have been reassured. Although I'm certain that he had a fairly high source of authority on the matter of the human predicament, which was the message that he was trying to get across to his church in Rome. My recent readings, coupled with scripture, lead me to believe that imperfection is in fact a blessing that makes us aware of our humanness, that makes us aware of our need for God, and that draws us inward to the divine spark within us that connects with God. When our children were little, I was fortunate to discover an organization called Parents Place, which offered regular classes in parenting taught by trained professionals. I took some classes and eventually became a member of the board. The classes were so helpful, and it was great to be with other parents who were undergoing similar, sometimes even more challenging problems with child rearing. I remember one lesson in particular because I used it so often. We were taught to respond to accidents without making a big fuss or assigning blame. If a child accidentally knocked over her milk, for example, the correct response would be, "Oops, the milk spilled. Let's it up. Much preferable to berating a child for being so messy. It was a great lesson that I used often. The problem, of course, occurred with the fourth or fifth spill. The oops, the milk spill came with gritted teeth. The let's wipe it up with a notable snarl. And I suppose some of those emotions were justified. Still, I didn't like myself much when I lost my temper with my children. And I especially regretted later overreacting in anger or frustration or just plain exhaustion to the relatively innocent antics of the girls. Just as an aside, I've noticed if you have grandchildren or you are have friends, nieces and nephews, the evolution of thoughts about child rearing are really interesting. Our daughter Julie, I admire so much. She when she had a toddler, her first daughter, she had a way of when Louisa would be fussy or headed for trouble, Julie would just redirect her. She didn't say stop, she didn't say no, she just redirected her. I thought, wow, that is just a wonderful way to handle these situations. We visited them last week. They live in Way, upstate New York in the Adirondacks. They now have, Louisa is 7, and they have also a 4-year-old. And I've noticed that Julie sometimes reacts with frustration and exhaustion. The gifts of imperfection. Paul talks about delighting in the law of God, yet being unable to follow it, instead being captive to the law of sin. We in the 21st century might state it a little differently, but we all do develop our own laws for our own lives. We hope they're based on Christian values and our efforts to be a good person, the way we understand that to be. Most of us, I think, share some confidence in the human potential for good. And yet, we know what it's like to screw up repeatedly by omission or commission. How often I resolve to be the good Christian driver, no matter who cuts me off or how dangerously other motorists maneuver their vehicles, I will be the one to compensate by driving slowly and carefully. Occasionally, I succeed. More often, not. You know how you promise to be patient with your spouse or your friend, despite that really annoying habit? You know the one. But you can bite your tongue only so many times. And what about your friend who offers up the most juicy bits of gossip? You know that's on the sin list, right? But really, you just can't stop her or him from talking. And it might be rude to stop listening. We don't know what specific issues Paul has with himself, but we can identify with his plight. We often don't understand our own actions. We do exactly what we resolve not to do and neglect the good deed that we intended. So we're faced with how to deal with this human condition. I personally have long questioned the doctrine of original sin. I prefer instead the perhaps less well-known doctrine of original blessing. But even though I don't believe we're born sinners, we can't dismiss all the times that we miss the mark. That's one definition of sin. We must confess the times when we allow our self-centeredness to turn us away from God, to distort our relationship with the divine. That's another definition of sin. By whatever definition you reach this conclusion, we are imperfect. In their book on the spirituality of imperfection, Kurtz and Ketchum say our shortcomings create in us a thirst for God, for the spiritual, for whatever might alleviate the pain inside of the human condition, for whatever might somehow fill the empty hole in our human being. A spirituality of imperfection, they say, is always mindful of the inevitability of suffering and causes humans to recognize their need for God. Sometimes we fill that empty hole, we all have it, we fill that empty hole with something other than God. Sometimes that creates in us an unhealthy addiction. The authors point to the importance of spirituality in Alcoholics Anonymous programs, but with an image of spirituality that's new to many of those struggling to recover. It's a spirituality that accepts imperfection. God comes through the wound, they write. The descent to the depths brings the realization that without help, one is lost. The spirituality of imperfection is the spirituality of the weak and the broken, the poor and the humble. Sounds like Paul, doesn't it? My favorite priest, Roman Catholic priest, Richard Rohr, believes we're all addicts. That human beings are addictive by nature. That's his definition of sin. Substance addictions, like alcohol and drug abuse, are merely the most visible forms of addiction, says Rohr. Other forms, we try, often unsuccessfully, but we try to keep hidden. I did not come for the healthy, says Jesus, but for those who need a doctor. I love how author Anne Lamott, after years of alcoholism, describes stumbling upon a tiny, progressive Presbyterian church that led to her sobriety. I came to church sick and probably smelly, she writes, longing for my pastor, for the knowledge of this higher power my pastor preached about, some sort of loving energy that animated all of life, surrounding, co-creating, indwelling, the love, capital L, who had worn sandals. Brene Brown says essentially the same thing, with added emphasis on acknowledging and accepting our vulnerability as part of our human condition. Brown researches and writes about human emotions and behavior. particularly in the areas of shame and vulnerability. Her research convinces her that people who are concerned about fitting in, about pleasing others, who are driven to hide their weaknesses, these folks are destined to unhappy, unhealthy living. Ironically, as Brown was doing her research, she discovered that she was one of those people. Her extensive research, which involved hundreds of interviews and analysis of participants in this program, revealed that wholehearted people, which is her term for the healthiest, most joyful people, these people claimed an essential element that she lacked: loving themselves. Knowledge is important, she writes, but only if we're being kind and gentle as we work to discover who we are. And like the other authors, she agrees that our imperfections are gifts that deepen our spiritual hunger, our thirst for God. Feelings of hopelessness, fear, blame, pain, discomfort, vulnerability, disconnection, these feelings sabotage resilience, she writes. The only experience that seems broad and fierce enough to combat a list like that is belief that we're all in this together and that something greater than us has the capacity to bring love and compassion into our lives. Broad and fierce enough. Contemporary studies of spirituality and gifts of imperfection lead to the same conclusion that Paul seemed to explicate when he cries, "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord." Our human imperfections truly are gifts to be embraced, gifts that allow us to tell the world that we are worthy. We are God's blessed creation. You don't have to pretend that everything's okay. It's not. You don't have to pretend that you're okay. You might even be brave enough, confident enough to share openly your vulnerability, your imperfection, publicly, or at least with your close friends or family. You certainly have a great role model in the Paul that revealed in our text today. We are human. Flawed and worthy. As you ponder these insights and wonder how we might harmonize these contradictions, perhaps we should recall an old parable. I try to keep this parable uppermost in my mind. It's about a grandmother who is speaking to her grandson and saying, we all, each of us, have inside of us a good wolf and a bad wolf, battling each other. The good wolf represents kindness and generosity, love. The bad wolf represents greed and selfishness and maybe even hatred. And the grandson thinks about this for a moment and he looks up at his grandmother and says, which one wins? She says, the one you feed. You know the one. The one Paul lives. The one Paul lives when he cries, "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord."
Church, the community.
listening brochure in your bulletin. The picnic is July 9th, 1 o'clock at Sue Chenault's house. And Kevin, is Kevin here today? Oh, there's Kevin. Kevin is going to take the bus from here over to the picnic if anybody would like to ride. Or if anybody needs a ride, let me know and we'll try to arrange something for you. But Kevin has been kind enough to offer to drive the bus for us. So thank you all very much, and I hope to see you at the picnic. It's going to be fun. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us quiet our hearts and our minds now as we turn to the Lord our God in prayer. Let us pray. God of light, God of love, God of all that is true and good, hear our prayer. Open our hearts that we might speak to you. Open our ears that we might hear you. We are grateful for so very much in this world. The sun, the moon, the stars, the earth revolving on its axis, the sprouts and flowers pushing their way through the soil, the sweet time of summer. We are so blessed to live in a place of beauty and safety. Remind us of the responsibility that privilege carries to care for the earth and the air and the water, to be good stewards of our resources, to waste not and to use wisely the great gift we have been given. Help us to bear this task with diligence and with joy, and never take it for granted. Thank you too, dear God, for our homes and our families and our church, places of rest from our weariness, places to refresh our minds and our bodies, places to laugh and play, to cry and dream, places to lift our lives in worship and in service. Help us, dear God, to examine ourselves, to look into our very souls for insight into our own failings, for which we ask your forgiveness and the ability to forgive ourselves. Help us to look so deeply that we might find you at the center of all things. Help us to be quiet long enough to hear your still small voice, calling us to live in the way of our loving Jesus, calling us to live humbly, gratefully, without anger or fear, without animosity or jealousy, but with empathy and respect for each other. We pray for those who are suffering in this country and in countries far away, especially we lift the people of Ukraine and also the people of Russia. May the love we hold for you grow so powerful that it overflows, yes, to our families and friends, but also to strangers, to bad drivers and annoying co-workers and neighbors, and especially to those whom we have thus far excluded from your kingdom, the hungry, the homeless, the bereft of opportunity and ability. May we be gracious and generous and inclusive. All we ask in his name, praying as he taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Us our debts, and we forgive our debts, and lead us not
This church is richly blessed and has important missions to perform. Let us worship God now, then, with our tithes and our gifts.
Thank you.
Lord.
Friends, and we have little time to gladden the hearts of those who make this journey with us. So be quick to love, make haste to be kind. Go out into the world in peace to love and serve the Lord, knowing that you are held in holy hands that will never let you go. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now.